one of the great pleasures for me about this book festival is catching really good up-and-coming authors right before they sort of hit it big. A couple years ago, we invited Helen Simonson, whose book broke it big right before our first festival. Last year, it was the same for Eleanor Brown, who was just around here somewhere. And so this year, my main literary talent scout, Becky Malone, saw an intriguing listing in a catalog of 2012 book releases. The book was called The Song of Achilles. It was by a first-time author, Madeline Miller. So it was a retelling of the classic tale of the Iliad, focused on that half-god, greatest warrior of the ancient world, Achilles. So we thought, plenty of great material. We noted at the time that the author also had some really interesting qualifications. She's a lover of mythology, a scholar of the classics, having earned undergrad and graduate degrees from Brown University. She teaches Latin and Greek. She spent time studying at the Yale School of Drama, focusing on the adaptation of classical texts to modern forms. So we decided that this was someone who'd probably have something to say and a great person to bring here to Gaithersburg. It wasn't until after the book came out, however, that we realized how right we were about Madeline Miller. The Song of Achilles is just fabulous. I remember enjoying Homer in high school, but it's probably been 20 or 25 years. I don't want to date myself, I guess, but I certainly only remember the most iconic of details about it. For me, Madeline's book really reinvigorated my love for the classics and Greek mythology. And this is key, you don't have to have read any of it or remember any of it to enjoy this book. Song of Achilles stands on its own. It's a terrific story. Miller's graceful prose and her overflowing love for her characters draw you in on some level, even if just in the back of your mind, knowing that she went back to the ancient texts to research these classical characters evoked a connection for me that and a feeling of kinship with some of our oldest literary traditions. So it was pretty cool. And so we were delighted to see that Madeline Miller was recently named a finalist for a major international literary award, the Orange Prize for Fiction. She deserves a round of applause for that. And we will be rooting for her when it's awarded in a couple of weeks. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a great welcome to a terrific up-and-coming author, Madeline Miller.
Thank you so much for that lovely introduction. I have had such a great day here. It has been so much fun getting to see all the authors and walk around. What a wonderful experience. So thank you all for coming to this. I'm gonna break out of the mold a little bit here if I can without breaking this. As a classroom teacher, I get freaked out behind podiums. So I would rather come out and speak to you if that's okay. My novel, The Song of Achilles, is a retelling of the myths around the Greek hero Achilles from the perspective of his best friend and lover, Patroclus. My interest in these stories goes back a long way. My mom, when I was about 5 years old, used to read the Iliad and the Odyssey and the Greek myths to me as bedtime stories. She always is a little nonplussed by me sharing this because she says it makes her look really inappropriate. But they were wonderful. From the first moment that she read, you know, "Sing, goddess, of the destructive rage of Achilles," which is the first line of the Iliad, I was totally hooked. I absolutely loved these stories. And part of what I think appealed to me so much was the fact that they felt intensely real. That even though they were filled with, you know, gods and monsters and divine intervention, that they were not about perfect heroes and sort of cardboard characters. They were about angry people and proud people and people who make disastrous decisions in very difficult situations. And so I sort of felt like here I was getting a taste of real life, even though there aren't so many divine visitations in real life. And so I just continued studying this, and I was very fortunate in high school to have a Latin teacher who also knew Greek, and he said, "I can teach you Greek and I can have you reading Homer in about a year." And I thought, oh my gosh, yes. So So that is how I first came to that. But none of this really was leading up to a novel. And I think that for me, what really happened was that I kept coming back to this moment in the Iliad. How many of you here have read the Iliad, by the way? Okay, oh good. So you don't have to have read the Iliad. But this terrible moment in the Iliad where Patroclus is killed. And Patroclus is Achilles' closest companion, his most beloved companion. And we don't actually hear very much about him in the Iliad. He's a very minor character. He shows up a little bit. You kind of see him in the background all through the time that Achilles is sulking in his tent, refusing to fight for the Greek side because of his conflict with the Greek general Agamemnon. So Patroclus is killed. And all of a sudden, Achilles just completely loses it. It is as if a bomb detonates in his life. And it's totally shocking and unlike anything else in the rest of the work. It's just an incredibly powerful, powerful moment. And I couldn't get away from it. I kept returning to it because I wanted to understand it more. Why does Patroclus mean so much to Achilles? What is it behind this relationship? What's this friendship like? And so that was really the idea that just I kept mulling over and mulling over. And I realized that I wanted to tell Patroclus' story and that I wanted to really understand from the inside out who was this person who could shake the greatest hero of the Greek army to his foundation. And that was really the beginning of the book. It took me 10 years to write, which was not planned. It just ended up taking that long. And partially it ended up taking that long because I was also teaching at the same time. And if it's okay, I'd love to embarrass some of my former students who are actually here, John and Eric. So thanks for coming, guys. And I have to say that teaching and being able to be talking about these stories at the same time that in the background I had sort of this writing going on turned out to actually be a wonderful, wonderful thing because I was experiencing it through the eyes of people who were seeing it for the first time, and that helped keep it fresh for me. And it was also great because it made me take time away from the story. And so even though I would be sort of going, you know, I would be teaching full time during the year, and then when it got to the summer, I would write, I would write 14 hours a day, 15 hours a day. I would just be a total, you know, in my room working on this story. And when you take so much time off from a piece and you come back to it, you really see where the problems are. So that it turned out to be a very helpful thing for me as a writer to really get some perspective on the piece also. So I'm going to read two sections today. They're both from towards the beginning of the book. One of the things about Patroclus that I discovered, as I said, there's very little about him in the mythological record. But one of the interesting things about him is that when he was a child, he was born a prince. But he accidentally kills another boy, this is mentioned in Homer, and he's exiled from his kingdom and taken in by Achilles and his father, sort of like a charity case. And that's how the two boys eventually become friends. So the first scene is gonna be right kind of at the beginning of their friendship when they're both about 11 years old. The second scene is gonna be when Patroclus meets Achilles' mother for the first time. And she's a sea nymph goddess. I will use this for the reading. Our friendship came all at once after that, like spring floods from the mountains. Before, the boys and I had imagined that his days were filled with princely instruction, statecraft and spear. But I had long since learned the truth. Other than his lyre lessons and his drills, he had no instruction. One day we might go swimming, another we might climb trees. We made up games for ourselves of racing and tumbling. We would lie in the warm sand and say, guess what I'm thinking about? The falcon we had seen from our window, the boy with the crooked front tooth, dinner. And as we swam or played or talked, a feeling would come. It was almost like fear in the way it filled me, rising in my chest. It was almost like tears in how swiftly it came. But it was neither of those. Buoyant where they were heavy, bright where they were dull. I had known contentment before, brief snatches of time in which I pursued solitary pleasure, skipping stones or dicing or dreaming. But in truth, it had been less a presence than an absence, a laying aside of dread. My father was not near, nor boys. I was not hungry, nor tired, nor sick. This feeling was different. I found myself grinning until my cheeks hurt, my scalp prickling till I thought it might lift off my head. My tongue ran away from me, giddy with freedom. "This and this and this," I said to him. I did not have to fear that I spoke too much. I did not have to worry that I was too slender or too slow. "This and this and this." I taught him how to skip stones, and he taught me how to carve wood. I could feel every nerve in my body, every brush of air against my skin. He played my mother's lyre, and I watched. When it was my turn to play, my fingers tangled in the strings, and the teacher despaired of me. I did not care. "Play again," I told him, and he played until I could barely see his fingers in the dark. I saw then how I had changed. I did not mind anymore that I lost when we raced, and I lost when we swam out to the rocks, and I lost when we tossed spears or skipped stones. For who can be ashamed to lose to such beauty? It was enough to watch him win, to see the soles of his feet flashing as they kicked up sand, or the rise and fall of his shoulders as he pulled through the salt. It was enough. Thank you. The second short section, as I said, is where Patroclus meets Achilles' mother for the first time, and she is a goddess. The next night, when the household slept, I climbed out of our window. The moon was half full, bright enough for me to pick my way over the rocks without a torch. He had said that I was to stand in the surf and she would come. "No," he had reassured me, "you do not need to speak. She will know." The waves were warm and thick with sand. I shifted, watched the small white crabs run through the surf. I was listening, thinking I might hear the splash of her feet as she approached. A breeze blew down the beach, and grateful, I closed my eyes to it. When I opened them again, she was standing before me. She was taller than I was, taller than any woman I had ever seen. Her black hair was loosed on her back, and her skin shone luminous and impossibly pale, as if it drank light from the moon. She was so close I could smell her, seawater laced with dark brown honey. I did not breathe. I did not dare. "You are Patroclus." I flinched at the sound of her voice, hoarse and rasping. I had expected chimes, not the grinding of rocks in the surf. "Yes, lady." Distaste ran over her face. Her eyes were not like a human's. They were black to their center and flecked with gold. I could not bring myself to meet them. "He will be a god," she said. I did not know what to say, so I said nothing. She leaned forward and I half thought she might touch me, but of course she did not. "Do you understand?" I could feel her breath on my cheek, not warm at all, but chilled like the depths of the sea. "Do you understand?" He had told me, too, that she hated to be kept waiting. "Yes." She leaned closer still, looming over me. Her mouth was a gash of red, like the torn open stomach of a sacrifice, bloody and oracular. Behind it, her teeth shone sharp and white as bone. "Good." Carelessly, as if to herself, she added, "You will be dead soon enough." She turned and dove into the sea, leaving no ripples behind her. So I would love to take questions if people have them. Yes.
Nobody ever wants to ask the first question. The voice that you come up with a very distinct voice for this character. Where did you summon that from? I mean, we're talking about a 4,000-year dead Greek god. Can't exactly call him on the phone there.
True. I think that was also part of the 10 years, is that about 5 years into the process of writing this, I had a complete draft told from Patroclus's perspective, and I ended up throwing it out completely and rewriting from scratch. And that part of what I was really looking for is that I felt I had the character and I felt I had the story, but I didn't quite feel like I had the voice. And what I wanted for the voice was, I sort of feel like I was coming from this epic perspective, that Homer's Iliad is an epic poem, and it's about epic ideas of war and gods and fate and sort of set on this, you know, huge scale. And what I realized is that Patroclus himself is actually not an epic person, that he is really much more from the vein of, in the ancient world, it would be called lyric poetry, of the poetry which is, you know, the poetry of friendship, and of kind of personal emotion and small daily beauty. It's not on the grand scale. And so what I realized is that I needed to give him a lyric voice. And once I kind of understood that, it started flowing. And I feel like this is also where my theater really came in handy, because I was used to listening to people's voices and trying to summon them into characters on the stage. I also direct theater. And so I think the combination of those two things came together, and that's sort of how I found the voice.
Going off of that, was it always first person? Did you always hear the voice in the first person that you ever contemplated throughout that first one, doing it in art? Because that would be a very, you know, I'm a storyteller, coming out this.
So the question is, was it always written in first person, or had I experimented with third person? By the way, this is a lovely Sarah McCoy who read here earlier. So it was always first person. That actually, when I sat down to write it for the very first time, I had just graduated from college, and I had this completely life-changing experience, which is that my senior year of college, a friend of mine had said, "Hey, do you want to direct this production of Troilus and Cressida with me?" And Troilus and Cressida is Shakespeare's Trojan War play. And I said yes, even though I knew nothing about Shakespeare or directing plays at all. But I felt like I knew the Trojan War, so at least I could bring that. Doing that production was just incredible. So here I am in the morning, and I'm meeting with Achilles, and I'm talking with him about his motivations. And then I'm meeting with Agamemnon about her costume. Our Agamemnon was a female, by the way, and her parents are actually in the audience, so. She was great. She's one of my best friends. But doing all that just completely blew my mind, because it was the first time I had really interacted with these stories in an active way, and not just kind of reading them on the page. And so when that experience ended, I found myself feeling really bereft, that I still really wanted to tell this story. And, you know, and it was Achilles and Patroclus whose story I most loved. And by the way, Troilus and Cressida, if any of you have ever seen it or read it, if you are Iliad myth lovers, I would totally recommend it. It is so great. It is angry and funny and really dark. It is a fabulous. I mean, Shakespeare really does not like the Greek leaders. He lets them have it, all of them. So I can totally recommend that. But it was almost like a trance. I sort of sat down in front of my laptop and opened it, and Patroclus's voice. So.
Yeah. I don't mind enough.
Please.
During 10 years of writing, how many times did you want to kill yourself?
There were some dark moments along the way, for sure. I mean, you know, it got to the point where most of my friends and family wouldn't ask me about the book anymore, because it was sort of like had gotten to that point where, like, she's never going to finish that. But every time I sort of thought, you know, I should just give this up. I'm so happy being a teacher. I love being a teacher. I don't need to add, you know, anything else. But I couldn't give up on this story. It was something that was so meaningful to me that I felt like I was abandoning Patroclus every time I did that. I needed to do it. So it sort of felt like, came to feel like I was standing up for him, you know, giving him his voice. So that was what brought me back on all the days where I was like, what am I doing? Yes.
Is there another story that's now running inside you from the classics or elsewhere?
The question is there another story that's burning in me? Yes. The story I'm really interested in right now, actually. So one of the characters that I was most intimidated to write initially was the character of Odysseus. Because here he is the wiliest of the Greeks. You know, he has a long and storied past in all kinds of novels and poems. And, you know, do I really dare to put words in this man's mouth? But as I started imagining him and his story, I came to really, really enjoy writing him as a character. And he made a fabulous foil to Achilles. I mean, the two of them are so different. You know, you have Achilles as sort of the impulsive young man who says the truth no matter what, and who, you know, there's so many times in the Iliad where it's sort of like, Achilles, if you could just take it down one notch, life would be a lot better for you. But he can't, because that's who he is. He's this incredibly passionate, idealistic young man who also has a rage problem. And then you have, and there's even this great scene where Achilles says, you know, I hate like the gates of death, the man who says one thing and hides another in his heart. And that is pretty much the definition of Odysseus, that he would just as soon lie to you as tell you the truth. He is, you know, the consummate diplomat, the manipulator, the politician, the mastermind, puppeteer. So his perspective was really great to have as a balance to Achilles' perspective, because of course they both have enormous strengths and enormous weaknesses too. So I want to finish his story. And I have always really loved the women of the Odyssey. They have been characters that really spoke to me. Penelope, his faithful wife, Circe, the witch, who turns people into pigs. These are characters that I really love and cherish, and so that's where I'm heading next. I don't think I'll stay in Homer's world forever, but for one more. Yes. I think it would have to be the right story. There are some brilliant examples of that. I'm thinking in particular of Mark Merlis's An Arrow's Flight, which is taking the whole story of Pyrrhus, who's Achilles' son, and kind of putting it in a modern day form, and keeping the gods and sort of the mysterious stuff. It absolutely can be done, and I would be interested in doing it. But I think the story hasn't presented itself to me that's right for that and for me. So maybe that will, you know, I'll have direct another play and something will will come loose. But I would certainly consider doing that. And before I was writing, I sat down to write this story. I wrote exclusively contemporary stories. So I think one day I will return to that. Any last questions? Yes.
Patroclus' mom. I first started reading your book, how vivid she was, and just how harsh you were to her in her description. It was immediately vivid. I was just wondering where that came from.
Do you mean Achilles? Do you mean the sea nymph?
No, I mean Patroclus.
Oh, Patroclus' mom. Okay. Nice. So even though both my main characters were male, I was very interested in women's stories from this time. And Patroclus' mother only really appears at the beginning, because then he kills the boy and is exiled and doesn't ever see her again. But she is sort of given in marriage to Patroclus' father, who is a very ambitious and cutthroat and not a very loving person. And she is brain damaged from being beaten by her father when she was younger. And sort of that Patroclus experiences with her and sort of seeing her life were very important to me in the formation of his character. And that if you were a woman in these ancient stories, life was hard. Life was hard. And I wanted to honor the truth of that. It's a very unfortunate and sad thing, but it's true. It's kind of a downer note to end on, sorry. Okay. Thank you all so much for coming.